And welcome back to Reliable Sources. I'm Frank Sesno, sitting in for Brian Stelter this week. The media on the ropes after being boxed out abroad during the president's trip and literally being body slammed by a political candidate. But criticism of the media has also come from the United Kingdom, when details of their investigation of the Manchester terror attack were leaked to the U.S. press. Those leaks included the terror suspect's name before the British authorities released it, information about the bomber's family allegedly warning police prior to the incident, and these photos showing possible materials from the crime scene published in the New York Times. President Trump ordered a full investigation. British authorities were furious, fearing their investigation had been compromised, and law enforcement officials there stopped sharing intelligence with the United States for a time. The incident raised lots of questions about leaks, news judgment, and access to information, only adding to the woes of an already beleaguered U.S. press. Joining me now to discuss this, bringing back Indira Lakshmanan and Michael Oreskes. Michael, to you first. You were at the New York Times. You've dealt with leaks and the decisions about what to put in and what not. What's the threshold here, and what do you make of this?
Well, first of all, it's our job to publish, and we certainly would always err on the side of getting more information out, not less. However, there are certainly many delicate situations in which you use care in what you publish. Crime scene photos is one of those examples. You want to be sure.
So how did this happen? So how did crime scenes, how did crime scene photos get published that were not supposed to be out there?
I can't say that they should or shouldn't have been published, because I don't know whether anything in those crime scene photos did in fact compromise the effort to catch the rest of that cell, which presumably is what the British government was engaged in. But every major news organization, including the New York Times, including the AP, where I worked for many years, has very strict rules about how we judge these things and how we make these decisions. When I was at the AP, for example, we held a story for more than a year that had serious allegations against about incompetence and misjudgments at the CIA, because we were afraid that the story might compromise the lives of certain people involved in the story. So news organizations are normally very meticulous about that. I assume the New York Times was meticulous.
Indira, after the 9/11 attacks, CNN said that it would be sensitive to releasing any information that could compromise lives or ongoing operations. That's how it was articulated at the time. Is that the basic threshold? That is to say, compromising lives or ongoing operations, that the press agrees, as Michael just said, to protect, to hold back on? And if so, do any of these complaints about these leaks seem to violate those parameters?
Look, I think the standard is exactly that. You don't want to put lives at risk, and you don't want to actually stop authorities from getting to whoever the perpetrator is. And I've been both a police reporter and a national security reporter, and these are decisions you have to make all the time in conjunction with your editors. But I do think that at large, you know, respectable news organizations that have a history of dealing responsibly with these things, like the AP, like the New York Times, like the Boston Globe and others, I think that this is dealt with in a responsible way.
Were these leaks irresponsible?
I mean, I haven't been on the inside with the New York Times talking to them about how the decisions were made, so I'm not ready to criticize them and say this was wrong. I would like to see proof from the British government that somehow this impeded their investigation or that some life was actually at risk. I mean, I have written about this, and in fact, you know, Dana Priest, who's won 2 Pulitzer Prizes, told me that she's come under so much pressure from authorities to not leak things. But she says, give me one case where actually something that we have written has put a life at risk or has stopped intelligence communication with other countries, and nobody can ever provide that concrete example.
Michael Oreskes, it's an interesting thing to think, too, about cultures of information here. You know, here in the United States, we have this thing called the Freedom of Information Act. In the United Kingdom, they have the Official Secrets Act. So we approach the release of information very differently. How large a role do you think that's playing here?
It's an element of it, I'm almost certain. The situation in the United Kingdom is much more secretive on a lot of these kinds of cases. But I have to say also, there's a lot of kind of hysterical commentary going on right now. I hope you'll forgive me, but I was watching another network this morning, and I happened to catch Homeland Security Secretary Kelly on, and he was talking about how these leaks bordered on treason. Now, that's just way beyond the pale. It's just silly almost, although it's very chilling. Treason is a very serious and very specific offense. and it's a capital crime. I think what we have here are professionals, professional journalists, professional people in law enforcement, and professional people in intelligence, each with their own need and their own service, all of whom believe they are serving the public interest. And the inability to talk with each other and discuss what the right solutions are is helping to create these situations and making it harder to bridge these cultural gaps.
I want to point something out that the public should understand, and that is just to the point that you are making, Michael, that in most cases there is an ongoing and active dialogue between executives in news organizations and top officials in government where these issues, these very issues, get talked out. Often they're not agreed to, but where government officials can bring their concerns to media companies and say, hey, look, here's what would happen if you release this, and sort of make that case. But I want to turn now to a related issue, and this is something else that makes the coverage of this story very difficult, and that is the quantity of coverage on the Manchester bombing and the acts of terrorism in U.S. media. Now, Indira, in your column, you wrote entitled The Endless Loop of Terror Victims, Lazy Journalism That Lets ISIS Run the Newsroom. You said some pretty pointed stuff. What do you mean here?
Well, I mean, to the last point you were making about leaks, I will say that a lot of newspapers and news organizations show very careful restraint. Like the Washington Post, for example, put a paragraph in their story last week saying, we are withholding the name of the city in which this ISIS plot took place. And I do feel like there's a danger of the pot calling the kettle black, President Trump wanting to go after journalists for leaks when he, in fact, is not at all careful with classified information, as we know from that meeting in the Oval Office with the Russians. My point on this larger piece was that, you know, I have been a journalist who has covered terrorism for years and years. Since the 9/11 attacks, I was in Pakistan the day after on September 12th and in Afghanistan on the day, when the Taliban fell in Kandahar. I think the problem with terrorism coverage is that we get into this lazy pattern where we take the cell phone footage of the victims running and screaming, and it gets played over and over in this endless loop on cable television. I understand cable television has 24 hours a day to fill, and so they have to use footage. But there is a way in which, how are we advancing what the public needs to know? What are we doing that is actually adding to the conversation other than giving ISIS and other terrorist organizations what they want, which is a platform and notoriety and fame? And it is a way that it has been proven helps them recruit.
But it is news, right?
It is absolutely news,
and we should cover news. And cable news does cover news by the moment.
And we should cover news. What I'm saying is we can cover it more responsibly. There are better ways to do that.
Michael, what are better ways? How do you do it at NPR?
Well, and NPR obviously has many of the same challenges that you have there at CNN and that Fox and MSNBC have, which is we're on all the time. So one of the really important things is to slow yourself down, take a breath, and try to make sure that what you have to say is something new or something that adds to the context or understanding to the light, not the heat.
I like that, slowing yourself down and taking a breath. That could be advice that that we should all follow.
We can all use.
And very much in the news business. So thank you both very much. And Michael, by the way, happy holiday birthday to you. I understand you're celebrating a little bit. So take five. Thanks very much to both of you.